Good morning. Welcome to worship this morning. A few announcements as we begin our worship today. Remember that today after the worship service, we have our annual meeting. So instead of getting up and leaving the church, just sit back down after we sing the amazing last song and stay where you're at, and we'll have our annual meeting right away in the sanctuary after that. And then after that, we'll have a potluck and fellowship time together in the fellowship hall. So we're looking forward to that. Also, thank you to everybody who helped out with the pictures this week. It was wonderful to get to visit with the ones that came in and out of the door, and thank you to everybody who sat at the table and tried to make sure we got all our information straight. I sort of have my fingers crossed that maybe we'll get our books by Easter, and I know that that is probably like optimistic, but we're working on them, and thank you for the work of doing it. Let's see. The youth group is planning a clothing drive for February. I'll let you just read the announcement about that in the bulletin. But if you're thinking about time for cleaning out closets, this would be a great place to donate them to. Bible Reads Hollywood, we're going to do for one more week. We got canceled one week in January because of this cold and the snow. So we're going to extend it into February one day. This week we're going to watch Secondhand Lions. It's a really fun show. As far as movies go. So come for that. We'll have potluck and popcorn. And then we're going to continue this group meeting together. I don't know if we'll watch a movie or if we'll come up with a different plan, but the third Wednesday of every month, we're going to have a potluck and something together. So mark your calendars for that. And then Todd and I are going to host a Super Bowl party on February 12th, and we're doing a Super Bowl food drive for the food pantry of our community and for our small little food pantry, and you can vote for the team that you most want into the Super Bowl. I think when I walked in the door, it looked like the Chiefs were winning in our congregation, but I don't know. Anyways, quite upset that the Vikings aren't in it. Not, yeah. Okay, and then the last announcement to make note of today. This is your last chance to sign up for Bible Camp and get the early bird registration form. So if you want to sign up for camp, do so by the 31st and you'll get $50 off. You can sign up for camp up until camp is happening, but the early bird discount is great. And our congregation does scholarships for pretty much anybody who wants to go to camp. And the general rule of thumb is if you're not in confirmation, it's a 50% scholarship after all of the early bird registration fees and things like that are taken off. And if you are in confirmation, the congregation covers 100% of the cost of camp for the first year that you attend. So, come to camp. Other announcements this morning? Let's begin our worship. In our prayers today, one more thing. In our prayers today, we lift up Gary Moore's brother, Wayne. Keep him in your prayers. He's struggling with dementia, Alzheimer's. And then keep Jim Farber in your prayers. He continues to be at Gateway Vista doing rehab, and it's just hard. So keep him in your prayers. And then, of course, keep the family of Margaret Weir in your prayers as well. Others today? Then let's begin our worship. We rise and sing together.
Thank you.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires are known, and from whom no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Gracious God, we confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves over into the power of sin. Hear the prayers of confession that we offer up silently now. In your compassion, Lord, please forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done, things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God is rich in mercy. He loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with the power of the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen.
Give us such a hunger and thirst for justice and perseverance in striving for peace that in our words and deeds the world may see the life of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Thank you. Our first lesson is from the prophet Micah. Hear what the Lord says. Rise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Hear, you mountains, the controversy of the Lord, and you endearing foundations of the earth. For the Lord has a controversy with his people, and he will contend with Israel. Oh, my people, what have I done to you? In what have I wearied you? Answer me. For I brought you up from the land of Egypt, and redeemed you from the house of slavery. And I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. Oh, my people, remember now what King Balak of Moab devised, what Balaam, son of Beor, answered him, and what happened from Shittim to Gilgal, that you may know the saving acts of the Lord. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God? The word of the Lord. Our second reading is from the book of 1 Corinthians. The message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since, in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided through the foolishness of our proclamation to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs, and Greeks desire wisdom. But we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those who are the called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God, and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. Consider your own call, brothers and sisters. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, things that are not, to reduce to nothing things that are, so that no one might boast in the presence of God. He is the source of your life in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God, and righteousness, and sanctification, and redemption, in order that, as it is written, let the one who boasts, boast in the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Please rise for the reading of the gospel according to Matthew, the 5th chapter. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up to the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will be called, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. At this time, I would invite our young people forward for a children's message. Knock, knock. Banana. Knock, knock. Banana. Knock, knock. Banana. Knock, knock. Orange. Orange, you glad I didn't say banana again? That is the most annoying joke ever, one of them, isn't it? There's a truth to every joke, usually, out there, right? The truth of that one is, yes, thank goodness, no more banana, because seriously, it is annoying, right? And life can be kind of annoying sometimes, but we put up with each other because we love each other. That's the truth of the joke, right? So, you know, it's kind of sad when you explain a joke, but the lesson today is about foolishness. Jokes are foolish, and sometimes they have a point, and they're kind of fun. The foolishness that our Bible passage is talking about, though, is the foolishness of the cross. And the cross doesn't seem so foolish, does it? The cross is pretty serious stuff. So why does Paul call the cross foolishness? Because isn't it weird that when God wanted to save the whole world, God didn't rush in with a great big army and power and might. You wanted to save the world, how would you do it? Wouldn't an army and power and might be pretty great? I want an army. Maybe, yeah. Yeah? God didn't do it that way. God's great plan was to send his son Jesus to die on the cross for us. The most awful place imaginable. So that when we're at our most awful imaginable, what's your most awful imaginable? Don't think too hard about that. But when you're there, God is with you and loves you. And just like the cross is not the end of the story, and death isn't the end of Jesus' story, your most awful isn't the end of your story either, because Jesus is with you and will one way or another see you through it. It sounds kind of foolish, to some people, some people will say, yeah, I don't know about that. But it's the truth. And it's the best news ever. Because we're never going to be alone. Love will be with us, God's love, and we'll get through it. Love heals us in ways that we wouldn't necessarily expect. When my kids get hurt, they only get a Band-Aid if there's blood. But you know what we do get? A kiss. Doesn't do anything, maybe. But maybe it does everything. Because maybe there's a whole lot of power in love. Let's pray. Gracious God, there's a truth in the midst of every foolish thing. Help us to see the amazing truth of Jesus on the cross and your amazing love for us always. Amen. Thanks for coming up today. I dare you to say that joke a million times over. To your parents, they'll tell you it's annoying.
Knock, knock.
Who's there?
Banana.
Okay, go home. Yep. Grace and peace to you this day from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. One of the very first lessons I learned in 4-H was one of dress code. I'll never forget it. I was getting vegetables ready for the county fair, and my 4-H leader said, all right, when you get vegetables ready for the county fair, first, go through your garden and pick out the best ones and make sure that all of them are uniform. All 12 green beans, all the same size, all looking pretty. Then, prepare them and make them look great, better than they look if you went to the grocery store and bought them. And then, when you're all done, even though you spent the last several hours in the garden and you are covered in mud from head to toe and probably have mud underneath your fingernails and all of the places, right? Go and get ready to present them to the county fair. Make sure you get the mud out of your fingernails. Make sure your hair looks great. Put on a nice outfit, because presentation is a huge part of the exhibit, and you're part of what you're presenting. Make the judge think that if they came to your house, your garden is always pristine and beautiful all the time, and that there's hardly any dirt to worry about. That's the image you present to the judges. Because image is part of what they're going to be judging on. It continued on, right? I got almost the exact same lecture from my speech coach. And I think all of the athletic kids in school got almost this exact same lecture from their coaches as well. The lecture from the speech coach went something like, it doesn't matter if you're nervous. Put on a great look so that you can stand tall and look like you have confidence, even if you're shaking underneath. I think the basketball coach said something like, we're all going to dress up and we're going to look like we can take on the world because it's good intimidation. It's a lesson that I've carried with me my whole life. Anytime I'm nervous about something, I put on a good look. Because at the very least, the outside of me says, I got this. How about you? It's all an act, though, half the time. There is no dress code in church. And yet, I look out here, and it all looks like there's a dress code. You must have had the same grandma I did. Grandma said, put on a good outfit for church and look good because, well, we're worshiping God. And so you show up, and you put your best foot forward, and it's a way of honoring the Lord. That's what my grandma said. But there's no dress code in church. And there shouldn't be a dress code in church. Because when Christ comes to us, Christ did not put on airs of any kind. Christ came to us in utter humility and meets us where we're at, always on the inside, not just by our outward appearances. Think of the story. Paul says, Christ crucified is foolishness to the Gentiles, foolishness to the Jews and a stumbling block and so forth to the Gentiles. Christ says it. And the stumbling block, when Paul talks about Christ being a stumbling block, the word is something like skellion. I never say the Greek. But that's the word. And it comes from, our English draws the root word scandal from this word. What Jesus does for us on the cross, Jesus' life, death, and resurrection, is a scandal to many, Paul says. Why? Because there's absolutely nothing dressed up about Jesus' life. When God sends Christ to us, Christ comes conceived by a mom out of wedlock. Christ comes born to Mary and Joseph, but Joseph's not the dad by birth, right? Joseph's the adopted dad. Thank you, Joseph. Good job. Christ is born in a barn. Christ is visited first by shepherds, people who are essentially homeless, people who wander around watching over sheep who graze in pastures that don't belong to those shepherds. As Jesus grows and enters into ministry, the wise and the learned are there. They're with him. They question him. They stand on the outskirts of the room with arms crossed a whole lot of times. But the religious are there, and so are some of those in government. The prestigious people, or the ones that think they're prestigious, are there. But who does Jesus welcome most often? He invites the fishermen. He invites the tax collectors. He invites the Samaritans. He invites sinners and prostitutes. He invites lepers. He invites a whole lot of people that often get pushed to the outskirts of society. And he invites them because Jesus came for all of us. And it wasn't that the wise and the learned and so forth were pushed to the outskirts. It was that they chose to stand there. Christ came for all of us. And then, when he pushed too many buttons and made too many people nervous, and when too many people started to believe that, yes, indeed, he might be the Messiah, the Son of God, those in power had him arrested on charges that were only half true. And then they had him crucified. Crucifixion was reserved for the most awful. The ones that the government especially wanted to make an example of. That's who gets crucified. There are many, many forms of punishment, right? But crucifixion is the kind of punishment that hangs the person who committed the crime on display for the rest of the world to see. That is the point of crucifixion. It is not only painful, and it is not only death. It is also humiliation. That's the point. Everybody who walks out of Jerusalem, everybody who walks into Jerusalem, and everybody who came just to be a spectator gets to see. Don't do what that person did. or you'll end up in the same boat. That's what crucifixion is about. And it is a scandal. But that is what God chose for God's Son. But God did it because we are foolish people. And because we teach each other from a very young age to put on a good face. To put on a good face. To put your best foot forward every day. To put a smile on your face and pretend to be confident even if you're not. To cover up the pain. Cover up the worry, to cover up the fear, to cover up anything that's even a little bit vulnerable. Dress yourself up for success. That's what we teach. But God knows. God knows. God knows our vulnerable. God knows we're not as confident as we look. God knows our fear. God knows the hurtful things that we think about each other. God knows all of it. God knows the things that are so painful that we don't even want to look in the mirror and see them of ourselves. And when God joins us on the cross, God promises that he's there with us. He's there hanging out in our broken. And that's the good news. It's a scandal. And we all live with our own share of scandals. We don't like to call them that. But we all have our skeletons, don't we? And Christ knows them and chooses to join us in them. Christ holds our broken. Christ holds the things that we don't want to share with anybody else. And Christ says to us things like, let's work on that. Let's forgive it. Let's trust it to God. Let's let go of the hold that it has on us. Let me help you heal. That's what Christ is doing on the cross for all of us. Let me underneath the image to the real person. And let's work on it together because I love you. That's how God claims us. God doesn't claim us successful people. When we are entered into the God's family, we do not come to the baptism font altogether. In fact, it's not even us that brings us to this baptism font. That's one of the reasons that we often baptize infants in our church. Because when we're baptized as an adult, we might think in our head that somehow we got ourselves to this baptism font, but one person or another told us the story of Jesus, and Jesus brought us to this baptism font, and Jesus claimed us as his children. You are broken, and you are my beloved child, and I will put to death your sins and forgive them and raise you to new life. And we'll start again and again and again until that day when we spend eternity together. That's the promise of our Lord. Our Lord is the one who joins us in the scandal and brings us to new life. That good news is meant to change us. It's meant to help us look at the world differently. What do you see when you look at other people? The truth of the story a lot of times is we see whatever image is put on the outside. And we make all kinds of judgment calls based on that image. But Christ sees who we are and chooses to work to love us as we are. And when Christ sends us out into the world, we are sent out to love as Christ loves. It is a hard calling, one that will probably never get right. I don't believe I'll ever get that right. I'm going to screw up time and time again and see what my eyes see. But I'm going to also pray that Christ works on me and helps me to see as he sees, helps me to love as Christ loves. Because Christ's love changes me and you and the whole world. And when we love as Christ loves, we are part of that change. Amen. Thanks be to God. At this point, I would like to invite John to come forward and join us as a new member of our congregation. John? What a joy. Dear friends, we give thanks for the gift of baptism and for John, one with us in the body of Christ, whom we welcome as a new member into the life and ministry of this congregation. With the whole congregation, let us confess our faith in the triune God in whom we place our lives and our trust. We use the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. In baptism, we are welcomed into the body of Christ and sent to share in the mission of God. We are called to live among God's faithful people, to hear the word of God and share in the Lord's Supper, to proclaim the good news of God in Christ through word and deed, to serve all people following the example of Jesus, and to strive for justice and peace in all the earth. John, do you intend to continue in the covenant of your baptism among God's people in this place? If so, please say, I do, and I ask God to help and guide me. And people of God, do you promise to support and pray for Don in his new life in Christ?
We ask God to help and guide us.
That's my favorite part. I have to say it every time. It's my favorite part because this is a team effort. Christ claims us in baptism, and we are community together. Sometimes we need the support. Sometimes we give the support. Let us be that community always. As we begin this journey together as brothers and sisters in Christ then, let us pray for this new member, for the whole church, and for all of God's creation. Lord, you make foolish the wisdom of the world. Raise up honorable leaders who seek justice, love mercy, and pursue peace. Frustrate plans that corrupt wicked and self-seeking. Prosper the work of peacemakers and work with each of us to risk love even when the world calls this foolish. Be with John as he joins us in this mission of Christ. Merciful God, hear our prayer. Cultivate humility in your church. In gatherings of every size, teach us to boast only in the cross. Shape your church to be people of kindness, generosity, and justice. Merciful God, hear our prayer. Bless all whom the world rejects. Accompany those who are regarded as foolish, weak, low, and despised. Reveal your power and presence at work where it is least expected. Give your life, strength, and wisdom to all in need, especially those that we remember in our hearts today. Merciful God, hear our prayer. Renewing God, you bring life out of death. Help us part with those things that are no longer beneficial to us and open our hearts to see where new life is budding in this congregation. We pray for this congregation, the annual meeting, and the mission that we are called to in the year ahead. Merciful God, hear our prayer. Eternal God, we thank you for the lives of those who have died, especially for Margaret Weirs. Make us confident in your promise of salvation and support us in our own journey of faith. Merciful God, hear our prayer. Receive these prayers, O God, and those in our hearts known only to you. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. John, we welcome you as a new member of American Lutheran. We rejoice to receive you and with prayer of God's blessings. Let us pray. We give thanks, O God, that through water and the Holy Spirit, you give us a new birth. Cleanse us from our sin and raise us to eternal life. Stir up in John the gift of your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever.
Second. Whoops, stay here. Got something for you. Silly stuff, but not really. This is your membership certificate. You can frame it if you want to. You don't have to, though. And this, I think I already gave you, but that's our devotional book, and it's kind of nice because every day there's a little something to think on. And this is just a coffee mug filled with chocolate and other things. But you don't have to drink coffee to be a member of our church. I'd recommend it, but you don't have to drink it. Anyway, just teasing. But coffee is something that I drink pretty much all day, and so when I look at my coffee mug, it always reminds me of things. And so this coffee mug has got our church's symbol on it, and it is our hope and prayer that when you're having a bad day and you need prayers, that you'd remember that you have a church family who promised today to be lifting you up in prayer and will. And when you see this, remember that you promised to lift us up, because on every given day, there's at least one of us who is in need of extra prayers. So take time to pray for your brothers and sisters in this congregation, and know that your brothers and sisters are praying for you. Let's welcome them. The peace of the Lord be with you all. Please turn to your neighbors and share that peace today.
Please rise as you're able and let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, maker of all things. Through your goodness, you have blessed us with these gifts, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Use us and what we have gathered in feeding the world with your love, through the one who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Christ invites us to his table, and here he feeds us with the presence of his love. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it. He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The meal is ready and all are welcome at this table. Please come forward as the ushers give direction. rise as you're able and receive this blessing. Now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you forever in his grace and love. Amen. Let us pray. O God, we give you thanks that you have set before us this feast, the body and blood of your Son. By your Spirit, strengthen us to serve all in need and to give ourselves away as bread for the hungry. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We are sent out to love and serve God with our lives. We go with God's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.